Morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee of 2023. The first item on our agenda this morning is to hear evidence on the Disabled Children and Young People Transitions to Adulthood Scotland Bill, and we have one panel of witnesses joining us today. So can I welcome Anne-Marie Sturrock, Vice Principal, Student Experience, Borders College, representing Colleges Scotland; Mike Corbett, National Official Scotland of the NASUWT; Dr. Fiona Whelan, Assistant Director, Accessibility and Inclusion, Student Services at the University of St Andrews, representing University of Scotland; and Louise Storey, Safeguarding and Practice Lead at the Donaldson Trust. Good morning. We have a lot of ground to cover today, so we will move straight to members' questions. And the first group of questions is from Ruth Maguire, please. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Last week in evidence, we heard from panel members about some of the challenges around supporting better outcomes for our children and young people with disabilities. They spoke about availability of services, about resources and capacity. I'm interested to hear your reflections on what you think the key barriers are in getting those better outcomes for our disabled children and young people as they leave school. And Marie, you're nodding and making eye contact, so I will come to you first.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Quite nervous, but some of the main challenges are the anxiety faced by families during the transition process and getting the right service in place for the young people and their family. So when, from a college's point of view, we try and go in at S2 and 3 to have that discussion. We also have school-college partnerships just to try and ease the transition. But it's a deeply personal experience for the young person and the family, and each person is different to the next. So getting that individualised support and transition is what's really key. And having a contact person for the family is really important. So the key challenges are, what's next? You know, my young child has gone through school and I've had a key contact, but what's next in the big bad world out there? And what we try to do in the college sector is just ease that anxiety.
Okay, and you spoke there about key contacts in the colleges. Would your members of Colleges Scotland have someone there specifically for a young person coming in and their families?
Each college has a student guidance and support team. And during the application process, if the student hadn't gone through the school's college partnership, we would invite somebody to put on their application form if there's a disability and if they would like a conversation with a guidance and support team member to ensure that the process and transition into college is smooth. There's a lot to get through. It can be very small to very big. You know, when I came in here this morning, there was a fire drill. So somebody with a disability may need additional support during a fire drill, something as simple as that. We need to establish, you know, what are the additional support needs so reasonable measures can be put in place. And that's a word that's bandied about, but it's individual measures what we need to address. Everybody is different who comes through with a disability, and everybody has different needs. So getting it right at the application stage and the transition stage is very important. And then that's in, but there's also the transition out of college upon completing of
course. Yeah, we'll talk a bit more about that in a wee while. If I could come to Mike on those key barriers.
Yeah, I think, firstly, there are probably too many competing policy drivers in the first instance. I mean, you've got there's responsibilities about additional support needs. There's GERFEC there, mental health and wellbeing now is promoted much more, and rightly so. There's a right for coordinated support plans already. And then we've got what's in the bill. And all of these individually, you know, are admirable, but there doesn't seem to be, you know, a coherence about these different initiatives that have come in at different times. And sometimes they've come in and they're not fully acknowledged when we come to the next new initiative. So I think that's one issue.
Convener, sorry to interrupt. Can I just use the word competing there? Is that there's different... are they actually competing, or is it more that it's a bit cluttered?
I think it's more cluttered, right, really. Okay. And sometimes, as I say, you know, well, let's take coordinated support plans as an example. So, that, you know, they're statutory, and you would think, you know, the statutory force behind them, so therefore that should be clear and they should be in place. But we have evidence, particularly from an issue we had in a special school a couple of years ago, and that's where you would expect a significant number of coordinated support plans to be in place. When we initially got involved in that school, there was a single coordinated support plan for a single pupil. So that shocked us because we were like, well, there's no way that should be the case. Mm-hmm. And that's just one example.
Yeah. So totally understanding what you're saying about that kind of complexity of policy and guidance, and that perhaps, you know, more adding to that might not be helpful. What is it about that complexity of policy specifically that gets in the way of there being better outcomes for disabled children and young people?
Well, I mean, talking purely from a school's and teacher's point of view, what tends to happen in practice is when you don't have a clear overarching framework or coherence about the variety of policies in place, and you know, local authorities often put maybe downward pressure on schools and teachers to be making those decisions and make things work at local level. And I think it came out quite clearly in Angela Morgan's report at one point that what ends up happening is you've got teachers at the sharp end doing their best in difficult circumstances, you know, trying to juggle all these different things without the appropriate resource, and I think crucially without time as the crucial resource to devote to all of the existing things, and that's why sometimes, you know, things fall through the cracks and some young people are maybe not getting the support that they need and deserve.
And as well as that resource and capacity bit, is it also about leadership then, if you talk about, you know, downward pressure on frontline workers?
I think so. And I'm not saying that it would be simple or easy, you know, to look at all of these different areas and try and bring together a coherent approach. But the lack of that and the leaving it to local level, which becomes leaving it to schools and teachers, certainly causes some difficulty, I think.
So would it be the view of you and your members that something needs to change, but perhaps it's not another layer of difference or complexity?
Yes, and I think that's one of the reasons we're a bit disappointed with the response to Angela Morgan's report, because I think a lot of people saw that as, right, this is where everything that comes anywhere near the banner of additional support needs potentially could be brought together and a coordinated approach taken. And I know it's partly when that report fell, you know, in terms of at the height of COVID, it maybe didn't quite get the attention and the commitment it deserved. But, you know, we're disappointed that maybe wasn't the signal to try and bring a lot of these things together.
Thank you, that's helpful. If I could come to Fiona now, please.
Yeah, so I think in terms of the barriers in that transition to higher education, and again, a little bit what Anne-Marie was saying about timings being quite critical, because our goal would always be to be able to put a support plan, an appropriate support plan in place for a student at the point at which they start with us. But there are challenges around that, particularly around the timings at which students are declaring a disability to us, and at which point we can really start to engage with them. So there's a window in summer where there's a lot of pressure on disability teams within universities to reach out to students, to do needs assessments, to help them apply for disabled students, so that, you know, on day one of their course, they have the support that they need. But we do know that students struggle with that, and that they will experience delays in getting the different support that they might need. And one critical area there is around the Disabled Students Allowance, for example. So universities and their disability teams will work and support students to apply for their Disabled Students Allowance, but to some degree it's outside of our control, particularly around SAS and just some delays in getting things in place for students, but the communication can be a bit of a barrier. So SAS, for example, don't tell a university when a student has got their award. So it's kind of left to the student to navigate those complex administrative structures. And I think there's something around joining that up better so that we can get those supports in place for students as quickly as possible.
Fiona, can I just make sure I heard you right? So from universities, we'll begin working with a young person in the summer before they attend in September?
Well, we can be in touch with students once they apply. So in my institution, for example, if a student declares a disability on application, we can start that conversation, but obviously conscious that students might be, you know, not sure exactly which institution they're going to go to. So that's why there's a window when a student gets their offer that we really ramp up our communication with students.
Can you tell me then, in your experience, who it is that's supporting young people and their families before they get to that stage? Because obviously there's some work involved there. So who is it in your experience that's supporting the young people to get to that application stage?
That one's probably a little bit more difficult for me to answer, but I know certainly that our admissions teams will work closely and do outreach within schools, and whether it's kind of guidance counsellors within schools that are providing that support.
I'd be really interested to hear that, so perhaps you could send us a note after, that'd be okay.
Absolutely.
Louise, can I come to you now?
Just to follow on from what Fiona was saying, I think the challenge that can sometimes occur is that not everybody recognises they have a disability. So they will not acknowledge that there is a disability and they want to fit in and not express that and don't really recognise that their condition brings a host of challenges and difference that makes barriers a little bit more complex for them. And I think that's a challenge as well. And I think that also fits with people who are undiagnosed, who are going through a process of diagnosis at the point of a transition and going into a service. So how does it work for somebody who potentially is going through the diagnostic process at the point of a transition and doesn't have something to confirm that they have a diagnosis? I think also identifying needs at the appropriate time to enable a more aligned person-centred transition for people. And I think that's about collaborative working between agencies and partners to recognise the needs. And sometimes that involves health being quite involved, and maybe it's not about social work and education at certain points in someone's life because someone's mental health or their health needs might be more pressing at that point. So how do we involve those people in those processes? I think the other thing that can be quite challenging is that for parents, it's at the transition is as much a transition for the parent as it is for the child. And I think parents finding out information about what the future holds at the same time as a transition process is quite challenging, because they're processing that as well as thinking about how do they prioritise the needs of their child and what do they need to be in a forum around a transition while they're trying to process what it means. Are they making the right decisions on behalf of their child? So I think perhaps looking at how we involve parents and what the future holds in a different way and engaging them at the right time in a transition process as well would be helpful.
Thank you, that's helpful. I'd like to ask about transitions within university and college and then on leaving, as Anne-Marie had started to speak about. So can you say a bit more about how young people are supported within college? We heard also some evidence about the need for flexibility, that young people may start something and it's not quite for them. What can colleges do to support that sort of situation? And you had started speaking about that transition out of college into the world of work or university.
So there are different transition arrangements for different students because there are different disabilities. If students are coming through with additional support needs, there's a very firm transition arrangement there between the schools and the college. If the student has been on a school-college partnership programme, doing a foundation apprenticeship or another similar course, there's a transition there between the guidance team. In terms of when the student starts the college, they will have a point of contact within the guidance team of a go-to person, and they're the kind of centre or point of contact between the curriculum and the needs of the student. That it's so personal, it's so individualised. You know, some students coming through need one-to-one support when they're at college, that throughout their college experience. Some people need help with their personal care. So it's so varied depending on the young person transitioning. But what the college has is a student and guidance team, very similar to the universities, where upon application, if it's not done through the school-college partnership, it's identified there and there's an opportunity to speak with our student and guidance staff. But I will echo what my colleague said. Quite a lot of students coming through may be going through a period of diagnosis, or they may not have gone through school and had identified as having a disability. And when I say identified as having a disability, diagnosed. So sometimes the college will, colleges, I can't speak for universities, will have to undergo that process along with the young person. And then that's where there's a bit of a gap, because it's about, we've now identified this, we start the process over again. And that could be in this, the middle of an academic term, where the whole support arrangements need to change for that young person.
And do you have any information on the outcomes for young people that come in on the different routes? I mean, you spoke about beginning to work with people in S1, S2, the school partnerships, or people who just apply. I don't know if the numbers maybe make it not possible to do that, but is that something that Colleges Scotland would look at?
So that is something Colleges Scotland look at. Education Scotland come and look at our equalities data while they come and do their progress visits. Our funders, which are predominantly the Scottish Funding Council, look at. We have an equalities reporting mechanism. So for people with disabilities, they have better outcomes than our care experience students. But we do have students who have multiple disabilities.
So my question was about the outcomes when the young people come in on the different routes. So if someone's had that support from school, there's been a school-college partnership, or if they come, do you disaggregate by that at all?
I can get that information. Really, I know the overall outcomes for people with disabilities in the college sector. That data has been released for 2021. But in terms of who's come through a process, I don't have that data.
All right, okay. And you spoke about the transition out of college. Do you want to say a bit more about that, how colleges support young people?
So the transitions in, to me, this bill will really firm up and set up a framework and a process to ensure nobody slips through the net. The transitions out is a bigger challenge, because you could have a young person starting university or college at 17. This bill goes up to the age of 26. So the transition then would either be to employment or to university or back to a service. So that's really an important process for the young person who is reaching a stage at their life where they may want to move out of their mother and father's or their carer's house and set up their own little abode. So the transitions out is the really critical part as well.
What's happening just now with that?
So it differs for individuals. So for people with learning disabilities, which is kind of under the umbrella of disability, we would continue our links with social work throughout the process. So what we don't want is somebody coming to college or university, finishing a course, or maybe not completing a course, and then lost. So during the process, we constantly keep up with our social work partners. For there's physical disability services as well. We would work with the health boards. But for our students with other disabilities, it's about their just making sure that their transition to university goes ahead, or employment is the big thing, moving on to employment agencies.
Thank you. Fiona.
Yeah, so very similar in terms of looking at that transition in and what we can provide to students. And there would be two layers for what a university can support students with. The first is the kind of the individual internal adjustments that we can make for students. So whether that's adjustments to teaching, their learning environment, their exams, and support with accommodation. And we know for some of our disabled students, it's really important that they can stay in halls of residence, for example. And that really helps with that transition to independent living. Which is a big transition. You know, it's not just about that kind of step up in learning to higher education. There's, for a lot of our students, it's leaving home for the first time and some of the loss of that one-to-one personal support that they might have had at home. And then the layer on top of that for our students would be those that are eligible for Disabled Students Allowance and the extra support that can unlock for our students. So whether that's through assistive tech, whether that's through non-medical personal helpers that can provide things like mentoring or study skills support. And as I said earlier, getting those in place as quickly as possible really helps to set that transition up for success. And all universities will have a team of disability advisors. They might set it up in slightly different ways, but students will always be able to access support from their disability advisor throughout their studies. And as we've discussed, that might be from disclosure pre-arrival, but it might also be the exploration of a diagnosis that students want to explore with us. So their status can change at any point during their time with us as an institution. And we do support with diagnostic assessments because Disabled Students Allowance, for example, does require evidence. And so that is one of the barriers, is that delay that students might have had support in place in school on the basis of needs. And now there's a requirement for some documentary evidence, and that can cause some challenges. So we do support students throughout their studies with us. And then, as we've talked about that piece about that transition out, and it can be quite multifaceted in terms of the support that students need. And we've talked a little bit about, you know, multiple disabilities, but there's also the intersectionality. So students who might be disabled but also care experienced and might have particularly kind of complex needs leaving us. So, for example, at my institution, we're talking quite a lot about leaving university well and what that means for students. So we work very closely with our career service to provide some bespoke information to our disabled students. We work quite closely, again, with our money advice team, so students who might then want to get some information about accessing PIP, for example. And then also involvement with social care and housing and things like that, so that students aren't afraid of what comes next. And anecdotally, they are. We did a joint survey at St. Andrews between the disability team and the careers service. And in some respects, we were really pleased by the survey. Students said that they felt very supported by the university, but also really afraid that they were facing a cliff edge and what that meant for them. So that's something that we've very much taken on board, and I know the sector does as well.
Thank you. We have some supplementaries now from Graham Day and then from Stephen Kerr. So Graham Day first, please.
Thanks, Convener. Morning, panel. I want to go back to something that Fiona Whelan's touched on earlier in evidence, because in University of Scotland's written evidence, they highlight very specifically an issue around students in that pre-arrival period, and in particular where they've had a conditional offer, and therefore it's very relatively late in the day before they know they're coming to that university, or the university knows they're coming. Now, the evidence that we've received suggested that there are issues there around just purely around timing, and that you can have a situation where returning students' needs are already known and they're almost ahead of the queue and trying to get the resource that's needed. And it can be very frustrating for the new students. How significant a problem is that for universities?
I mean, to some degree, it can be a resourcing issue within the teams. If you have sufficient capacity, you should be able to manage that. One of the challenges that we particularly find is we hit an embargo period in August where we can't communicate with applicants. And that actually does slow us down, because there's no reason that we can't be in touch with students who might have a conditional offer, just to kind of start that dialogue and that conversation. And they might feel comfortable sharing any documentation that they have with us. The embargo hits and we cannot communicate with them. And so it's a very short window, maybe 1 to 2 weeks, where...
Sorry, what's the embargo?
So the embargo is through UCAS, where effectively universities tacitly know the results that students have, but it cannot be communicated in any way. So it's a very specific period to make sure that universities don't accidentally indicate to a student whether they have an offer or not. So effectively, communication with applicants has to shut down, and that's from UCAS. So that is another barrier that we have in terms of communicating with students. So we do as much as we possibly can before that period, but equally, we do have students who don't want to declare a disability at application. And I think over the past 5 to 10 years, there's been really great strides in changing the perception that declaring a disability is a taboo, or that if you declare a disability to the university, your offer is going to be revoked. But I think there might still be that perception for some students, and that's why we do get late declarations as well.
Okay, if I may convene, if you indulge me, probe this a little bit more. So there's a reference in the written evidence to the issue of the schools being closed at that point. To what extent would you be able to explore with the schools the specific needs? To what extent are you permitted to explore with the school the specific needs of a student who may be coming to you?
I mean, by and large, we communicate with the student, and we wouldn't really have much communication with the school, if any, really. And that's certainly the experience that I have within my service, is our dialogue is with the student, with their consent, it's with the parents, if appropriate. So it really does rely on the student actually communicating with us more so than with the school. But there potentially is a role within the schools to help students understand that administration that's needed in order to get the support put in place when they join us.
Okay, thank you. That's useful.
Stephen Kerr?
Two quick questions.
Thanks.
Mike Corbett mentioned conflicts of policy. I would suggest that there's quite a clutter of policy, and it's quite hard to discern exactly how these policies often work together. Sometimes they don't. Does this bill add to that clutter, or does this bill facilitate some understanding about implementation among practitioners?
I think, you know, for us, it does add to the clutter and potentially add to the workload, ultimately, of teachers if there's not, you know, a better overarching coordination, which has to come from outside schools, I think.
Right, that's very clear. And Anne-Marie, you interestingly said in the evidence you gave earlier that you felt that the bill would firm up arrangements for transitions out of college. How did you come to that conclusion?
So just from reading the bill and the question asked by the panel in advance, so when I always look at this from an end user's point of view, so I would agree with my colleague, the people who are using this are people with disabilities and their families and carers. We're the implementers of the bill. So my kind of policy is, well, let's keep it simple and make sure it interconnects with others. The difference with this bill, when I was talking to my colleague outside, is that it does provide a framework that every person who has a disability will get a transition plan from school to college or university. And that's what I liked about it. So that, you know, we have the GERTFEG, which is getting it right for every child. We have the additional support needs. We have the UN Convention of the Rights of People with Disabilities and how it filters down. And just from what I looked at it, it kind of brings it all together. But I do agree, it can be very complex if you're a parent and you're really worried about your child moving on and what's the next stage, and you want to go and look at a piece of advice. There might be a little bit too many. You might go to GERTFEG and get the information there. You might come to this bill. So we would always have to ensure that our parents and the people with disabilities that we support know the rights according to it. The communication and the imparting the information of this is really important.
And that is the situation now, isn't it?
Mm-hmm.
So what does the bill, as it stands, change?
Well, we were talking about this in the lobby as we were waiting to come in here, and we were discussing what's so unique about this. And, well, it's a bill, you know, so there's a right to it, but there's also a framework for parents to work within and young people to work within.
Right. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Stephen, for asking that selection of questions. Bob Doris, you have a supplementary on this before I move to Michael Mara.
And for once, it is a bit of supplementary, convener. Anne-Marie Sturrup, what the committee is trying to wrestle with, I think, was what you've said and what Mike Corbett said. I think Mike Corbett said that there's a right for coordinated support plans currently, and that's a statutory right that exists, but it doesn't happen consistently or regularly. And Anne-Marie, you were suggesting, I hope you're absolutely right, that this framework means there'll be a more consistent, streamlined approach to making sure all young people get those rights and transition that they're entitled to. So my question would be, if it's not happening with coordinated support plans, why would it happen under this bill differently?
Who's that going to?
So Anne-Marie Stirrup, you don't have to have an answer to that. Yeah. I'm mirroring what the committee's wrestling with, which is why I want to give you the opportunity to say a little bit more about that. That's all.
It has been an evolving process over the years, capturing people with disabilities within the education sector. You know, when we report back to our funding council now, there's a numbers of disabilities that we get, but some people we don't actually realise there's a disability until they come to college or university. So it is difficult to capture everything, what this is setting out to do. And the purpose of this is to get better outcomes for people with disabilities in Scotland.
Right. I think that is helpful. A more consistent capturing of those with disabilities. Mm-hmm. We'll talk more about that later. Thank you very much, Convener. That's helpful.
Thank you. Does anyone else want to respond to maybe yourself, Louise?
Yeah. I think it gives clarity. I think it gives clarity to what's required. So the Additional Support for Learning Act gives information about coordinated support plans, identifying needs. This bill also talks about identifying needs, and it would be interesting to see if the identification of need within this bill correlates with what the Additional Support for Learning need, statement of need is. And I think it's about the reach of this bill in terms of who's accountable and who sees responsibility within it. So Additional Support Learning, we look very much at education, and we look at that period of a person's life. This goes up to the age of 26. So therefore, who are we capturing in terms of the audience to have responsibility and accountability under the Act?
Thank you, Louise. Michael Mara, can we move on to questions from yourself now, please?
Thanks, Convener. And it does follow on reasonably closely, I think. It's about the gap between implementation of policy and duties. I mean, would the panel recognise this discussion we've just had at the moment about whether we call that clutter or the search for clarity, that the outcomes at the moment are not good enough in terms of those there? I mean, Mike?
Yeah, absolutely. And as I say, it comes back to the fact that for us, too many of those decisions are not just left to a local level, but pushed down onto schools and teachers. And for us particularly, I think, it's the teachers are your guidance pastoral teachers who, in most schools, I mean, they don't have a consistent approach in terms of the time they get to devote to that side of their work. So you go from one local authority to another, they've got a different policy in terms of that time. So that is a huge challenge, and one of the reasons why we end up with, you know, different levels of support at school level.
Okay, that's useful. Can I maybe come back into some of the areas? I was interested in this, I suppose, part of bridging that gap between implementation and the experience. And I was interested in some of the longer term planning, because this bill deals with young people from the age of 14. I mean, how many, what kind of proportion, Marie Sturikov, young people with disabilities entering college come through a school college partnership? Do you have any information on that?
I do. Sorry, yes,
please.
I do. So in colleges across Scotland just now, there are 30. Sorry, this is from last academic session, because we don't have, our students are still starting. We have 32,987 students who have identified with disabilities. So that represents 15.4% of the student population in Scotland's colleges. Out of that 32,987, 9,612 have identified with multiple disability, and out of that 15.4%, 12% have come from schools. So some people, we also offer education to our adult learners as well. So there is quite a high proportion of students who come through the school system.
But through a school partnership programme?
Yes, across Scotland.
Yeah, okay. And could you, do you have any indication of how many young people who are seeking to access college defer entry due to a lack of support being in place?
I don't.
You don't?
No.
Is that something the University of Scotland would have? Because I've been told that this is a significant problem for young people, that perhaps the package of support they require to make the kind of transition we're talking about isn't in place.
It's not something that I have to hand, but it's something that we could look at, see if we can provide that.
I think that would be really useful to provide that to to the committee. And I suppose they reflected on these school college partnerships, understands that some of the colleagues are exploring the challenges of the universities around acceptance points. Is that kind of a programme that universities run in terms of a school university partnership with children with disability?
I couldn't say definitively across the sector, but I know that many admissions teams will have bespoke outreach teams that work in different areas, so around unwinding participation, for example, and disability. So many admissions teams will have bespoke programmes for supporting our applicants, and University Scotland is currently running a pilot project on supporting disabled students through the admissions process, and I know that there's going to be some key principles that are going to come out of that. So that's quite exciting as to how we can make that process smoother and more clear for students as well.
Okay. And so your kind of longer term, there isn't really a longer term plan around students' disability. It sounds like there's a real rush in that period as identified in the written evidence and you've been exploring with colleagues within a very contained period of time to try and address the issues of application. Are you constrained by capacity to deal, not with that process, but actually to deal with students with complex needs?
I mean, it will depend team by team. I think across the sector, there are concerns about capacity, and it's a hard metric. You know, the ratio of a disability advisor to number of students isn't an accurate or meaningful measure, because a student with dyslexia could be quite different from a student, let's say, with multiple disabilities, and the needs there are going to be quite different. But it is something that we talk about in the sector around resourcing, because yes, we have that critical period at the start of an academic year for new students where, you know, we try and get the support needs put in place based on the information that we have, and we can build on that. And one thing we always say to students is it's always an ongoing conversation. As you adapt to life at university, you might find that there are other things that are going to emerge that you're going to need to adapt, or we're going to need to add to your support plan. So often what we're trying to do is get the essentials in place and then build on that to support the student throughout their degree.
I suppose I'm interested in around that, whether the kind of the concept of transitions is something across all organisations that you feel is embedded in the culture, the way that you deal with disabled young people. I mean, there's a lot of the words you're using, Dr. Whelan, around adaptation, addition. You know, it feels like coping, perhaps, rather than dealing with that transition phase, which clearly has to start prior to arrival or acceptance. Would you think that transitions is a concept that the sector understands and sees as central to what they do?
Absolutely. But I think one of the challenges that universities are going to have is that they're going to be dealing with disabled students coming from multiple different areas. So we would have Scottish students potentially coming with support from local authorities, but potentially not. Then we've got students coming from England, Wales and Northern Ireland, different systems that we have to work with. And then for many universities, we're going to have a large cohort of international students. And one thing that we really strive to be able to do is to provide a consistent experience for students, irrespective of where they're joining university from. That's not without its challenges, because some students will be eligible for disabled students allowance and some aren't, and that does create to some degree a bit of a two-tier system. There is certainly a drive across universities to recognise that while there's a need to put in place individual adjustments based on individual need, there are things that we can do as a sector to strive to be more inclusive. So embedding inclusive practice and universal design for learning, so that some of the main adjustments that we would put in place for students would actually be accessible for all. And we've seen through the pandemic that some of those adjustments have been hugely beneficial for our students. So access to online learning, access to open book exams, more flexibility and choice embedded their degrees, all of that has helped to improve the outcomes for our disabled students. So we really are trying to support all students, irrespective of how much the support they've had or not had before they join us.
I wonder if Louise had any comments on that, just as almost an external look.
Yeah, I think when you talk about transition being embedded, I think the people that are sitting here on the, uh, on the understand that, and I think the services that we work in with the people that we meet understand that and the need for that. I think our experiences will probably vary greatly based on some of what Mike has said around pressures, resources. I think also that other external agencies and partnerships who you work alongside to support that person have different views on priorities within transition, and I think that's due to resource pressures. I think it's due to understanding and experience, and I think it's about understanding the broad diversity of people and recognising that some people need a little bit of extra support and they might not see that, and they rely on us to give that information, and then quite often rely on us to lead on the actions to implement a transition and take that forward. And I think that aligns with what Mike was saying about the additional pressures on people in front line to embed that, because they have the relationship at that point with that person, and they are the person that are committed, that based on that relationship, are probably in some cases best placed to bring about an introduction of change and a concept of what life might look like. And I think that is based on relationships, and I think that part of transitions is about building relationships and who we identify to come into someone's life to really truly understand what they need and for them to really get that. So I think, yes, we understand it. I think the experiences we have are variable, and if we have variances in experience as providers and as people who support transitions, then what is that like for the people that are experiencing that transition, and how do they make sense of that?
Thanks. And on that, Louise, perhaps if I ask this quite sort of a curtailed question, it might help Mike and Louise and you guys to come in. So you've mentioned about how you understand the principles of transitions, but that there's variable experiences. So what are the reasons, the specific reasons that you can identify between the gap between the implementation of the policy and the concept of transitions and the duties that are there with what's experienced by our young people? Mike, can I come to you first?
Yeah, I mean, a lack of time for guidance teachers in particular at the sharp end is certainly an issue. So they're doing their best, but sometimes from local authority to local authority with a different amount of what is often called management time to do that. And then, as I touched on earlier, if you like, a lack of leadership outside of the school as well. But I think what was touched on there, I think, is important, is difficulties in taking that joined-up approach. So something as simple as if a guidance or pastoral teacher is trying to get together a social worker and someone from, you know, from the health sector, etc., you know, just the time that sometimes takes, because those other areas of the public sector are struggling with staffing, etc. You know, that also, you know, feeds into it as well at a school level. And I think the other thing that I would touch on finally, just given some of what's been said earlier, is I think that school and college partnerships are more well established, and so perhaps there's some better work going on there just because the relationships that already exist. But that kind of relationship between schools and universities doesn't really exist. There is not as strong, for the reasons that have been outlined earlier, because no one knows sometimes which university someone's going to go to because they haven't had their offer, etc. So that obviously is a challenge as well.
Thank you, Mike. Louise, can I ask you to respond? Thanks.
I think to give an example would be the transition from children to adult services. So you can be working with one local authority area, and policy and practice varies greatly across the departments, and therefore that transition between one department to another is hugely difficult. And then in some cases we support people that have no social work involvement, no support involvement, so when they are transitioning on with no scaffolding around about what the next destination is. And I think certainly the children to adult services transition is hugely difficult, and you can work with one team and one authority and think that there's going to be a seamless move from one direction to the other, and actually it's not that experience at all. So you can have a child that is actually still in education but receiving an SDS budget for support out with school hours, so falls under an adult legislation, and there you're kind of crossing the barrier between the two. So how do you support support that person adequately, and how do you make sure that there's partnership working between the departments and interdepartment and interagency working? And that's hugely difficult, particularly in cases where a child maybe is in the process of transition from one department to another and has not been allocated, so therefore there's someone in the ether. And that's hugely difficult when someone has been discharged from children's services, not picked up by adults at that point.
Thank you. And specific examples like that are very helpful. Can I come to questions now from Graham Day, please?
Thanks, Convener. I've got three questions, but the good news is they're mostly focused on universities and colleges, so you won't all have to answer those. The first one concerns the Independent Living Fund and the Disabled Students Allowance. I know Fiona Whelan touched on the latter earlier. I'm interested to explore with you the extent to which those interact with the experiences of the students and the support that's provided to them, how effective they are in delivering what the students need or supporting them to go through college and university.
I can speak to the Disabled Students Allowance, which I think for the students that receive it can be hugely beneficial, and it actually can make all the difference. Very much dependent on the individual need, the disability, and what that needs assessment comes out with. But the access to assistive technology, the access to, to physical equipment that they might need, and then as I've mentioned before, the potential to access relevant one-to-one support. And that could be study skills support, study skills coordination, mental health mentoring. I mean, that can be incredibly beneficial, because that's a category of disability types that we've seen the biggest increase in terms of declarations. So for students, being able to access that support can be absolutely critical. But it is a challenging process for students to understand, particularly if maybe they've gone through school and been able to access support on the basis of need, not on evidence. And so they enter university and we provide support and guidance about what a needs assessment is and then the application for the Disabled Students Allowance. And it's left to some degree to the student then to figure out what that means, what that support package that is recommended is. And it can be delivered in different ways. So for some students, they will get a recommendation of here's your suite of support that's paid for. For others, the money just gets put into their account and they don't quite know what to do with that. And that's where one of the key problems we have at the moment, and it's very specific to SAS in comparison to the other funding bodies, is that we as a university, we will sign off the needs assessment by and large for the student, but we're not allowed to know when they've got their award. So we can't say to them, great, you've got your award, let's talk through the different support and how we put that in place. And that means that some students do get missed. And it does mean that we don't provide accurate reporting on the numbers of students in Scotland who have DSA.
Okay. And what about the Independent Living Fund? What's your experience of the impact that has on supporting students?
That's not something that I have much awareness of.
Anne-Marie, no?
No, I'm sorry, I don't have much awareness of that.
Okay, let's move on then. So the students are in your midst, you've identified what their needs are and you're supporting them. How do you monitor any changes in their needs? How do you monitor whether there's something you've missed and then seek to provide that support?
I think that could be done in many ways, and I think most universities would strive to have a very constructive and open relationship with students so that they know that they can come to us if there is anything that they want to discuss, if the support put in place isn't working and that they need any adjustments. But that does rely on the student being proactive about that. So obviously there's other mechanisms that universities can put in place to spot students that might still be struggling or might need something in addition. So, you know, across the sector, it would be quite standard to have staff within schools that would have a role. So, for example, at St. Andrews, each academic school would have a disability coordinator. That's a link between the central team and the academic schools. And that is a point of contact for a student in their school, but also a point of contact to spot any issues and say, you know, this student's not performing maybe the way that they had expected to. Can they come and have a conversation with you? So we will monitor students' performance as a metric. It's not a perfect metric, but we do try and track students, and there's a lot of discussion in the sector about kind of learner analytics and whether that could be a way that you could do an earlier intervention with a student that might be struggling. But I think there is certainly a role for academic staff in being disability aware and being able to feel confident in supporting students, spotting students, having a gentle conversation with the student to say, I've spotted something maybe in your essay, do you want to go and have a chat with the disability team? So that's another route that we can use to spot students that might be struggling.
Anne-Marie.
So slightly different in colleges is that most students get a 1 hour tutorial every week. So within that tutorial, the student would meet their tutor and discuss their needs. In terms of students coming through who have disabilities, that is an evolving process throughout the academic session. I have had experience of a student who has a disability through the transition process, had a one-to-one support worker, but very, very quickly realised, I'm not going to blend in here if I've got my shadow here, so asked for the removal of the one-to-one support worker and asked for the support worker to be at a distance, so there was a kind of I just want to blend in. So and that's done very, very regularly throughout the process. Then we also have the student guidance and support team who are a point of contact for that individual also. So the individual could have their tutor to go to, or they might go to our student advice and guidance, and it's just the flow of information is really important. So throughout the academic session, it's done. We have recording systems as well, attendance, we look at our early withdrawals, but we don't want to get to that stage. We just want it to flow. We don't want it to be data driven. It's very personalised.
Okay. My final question is about the preparedness of students to come to universities and colleges, particularly colleges, I suspect, in this instance, through the careers information, advice and guidance, and the extent to which students are encouraged to look at courses which suit them, but also meet their ambitions as well. And I'm always struck by something a college principal told me. Their college runs land-based courses involving animal husbandry, and they had quite an attrition rate and a developing attrition rate, dropouts from those courses, because they had a large number of students who had mental health issues, who had been encouraged or directed to go on those land-based courses on the basis that, well, it would be good for you to work with animals. They got to the college and found that as individuals, those courses weren't suitable for them. Is that, I'm not going to suggest that's commonplace, but is that something that you have to contend with at colleges?
Yes. So it's managing expectations all the time. In colleges, we work, and it's not exclusive to people with disabilities, where people think they know what's best for you, mm-hmm. and it's taken into account the wants and the wishes of the young person. That's the most important person in all of this. And parents are very important, are their carers, but sometimes it's what the young person wants and listening to that voice and not what maybe, this is where my dad works, I'm going to go down there, or this is where the school suggested I should go. It's listening to the student that's really important. So we do have experience in colleges where young people with disabilities come through and on a particular course, because that's what was perhaps suggested for them. But that's not set in tablets of stone. We're quite flexible. So within a very, very short space of time, you'll realise this isn't going to work. They just don't like it. Some people might say, oh, it's really nice to go work with children, and then the young person doesn't like children. So, and or maybe just that's too big a term. Not that they don't like children, but they don't want to pursue a career.
We get what you mean.
But we have mechanisms in place to transfer students to a different course. One of the things that colleges are working on is setting up broad-based courses, so young people can make an informed decision about what course they want to do, rather than decide this is what, and I'm not saying teachers say this all the time, but this is what my guidance teacher thinks I should do. It's about working together and listening to the young person. And there's pathways. If they don't meet the entry criteria at an SCQF level 7, well, there are pathways at level 6 and level 5.
So is there a genuine issue here with young people with disabilities perhaps being pigeonholed when they're being directed towards college, university, an assumption made about the limitations they might have?
Keen to come in, I think, on this one.
Yeah, I think you're right, and I think it's because of a lack of understanding of what people need. I think it's about a lack of understanding of how to communicate and to express experiences and what experiences might look like. I think there's probably a lot of work to be done about supporting students to make informed choice, to understand it, for people to recognise that someone having an interest in something or a strength in an area doesn't mean to say that they're going to pursue it as their life's journey. And how do we ask those questions? And I think that's really, really important. And I think that starts at that point. When do we intervene in a transition for somebody that's about gathering that information and allowing them to have their voice and for them to understand what it means? Because what they think they like and actually what something, an experience might look like, can be two different things. And I think it's really important for people to understand that. And I think there's a bit of work to do there. And I think from a policy and practice point of view, I think for some people it's about identifying that someone has a destination to go to, but is that the right destination? So in some agencies they might have achieved what they've set out to achieve, but is it the right outcome for the person?
Yeah. Okay, thank you, Convener.
Is anyone else wanting, Michael?
Just briefly on that point, I mean, I think that careers information and the information that pupils and students get via guidance and pastoral teachers has vastly improved from perhaps what it was decades ago. But there are still some inevitable conflicts, and sometimes they're between the pupil and the parent. And I think the most important point is perhaps what Anne-Marie touched on, that I think nowadays there is much more recognition that, you know, a decision you might take as a school pupil going on to college or university is not a final decision. Those, you know, colleges and universities are much more flexible about, if you've not made that right choice first time, to move to something else that does suit you better.
Thank you. Thank you very much. We've spoken a bit earlier on about the cluttered nature of all the various legislations and strategies and policies that are in place right now. So I suppose in quite a direct question to each of you, and I'll start with Mike if that's okay. Is this legislation actually required to create better outcomes for disabled young people?
Is it required? Do there need to be better outcomes? Yes. Will this legislation on its own guarantee those outcomes? I'm not so sure, for the reasons aforementioned, particularly the fact that there's a statutory duty about coordinated support plans that itself doesn't seem to translate to best practice on the ground everywhere.
Thank you. Louise?
I would agree to a degree with Mike. I think with the ESL and education legislation and looking at the age range of this, then introducing the legislation to take people through their lifespan, it might give more accountability to other agencies. And I think for me that's a little bit about how do we pull other agencies into the responsibility within this. So I think, yes, it gives clarity, and I go back to that point of clarity. I think the management of the plan for me when I was going through it is the huge bit, because how are we responsible, how are we accountable, and how do we monitor and evaluate it?
Thank you. Fiona?
Yeah, I think as a sector we would have a clear view as to whether it was required. I think, as you said, Mike, do we need better outcomes? Yes, and this could be a tool that could help with that. But from a university perspective, it would be beneficial to a smaller cohort of disabled students. And as I said earlier, we are looking at the bigger piece around all of the disabled students that are with us, whether they're from Scotland, England, Wales, or, you know, overseas as well. So it would just be a small piece for us. And it would really need to fit in with all of the other duties that we have as well.
Thank you. And finally, Anne-Marie, do you think the legislation is required?
Yes, I do. Do you think that there's a gap in terms of, we were just talking about 14 to 26, there are transitions from primary to secondary also for disabled people?
Thank you. Can we move on to some questions now from CoCab Stewart, please?
Thank you, Convener. And just for absolute transparency, I am a member of the NASUWT currently. So, I think that Mike is probably maybe expecting more difficult questions on that. I'll try to be as non-biased as possible. Just moving on to who the bill should cover. So the bill defines the child, obviously, as under the age of 18, but the range of it goes right up to 26. So that's a huge band there covering schools and further up. And we all know that, you know, teachers in schools are faced with a wide variety of pupils and needs in front of them on a daily basis. So do teachers in mainstream schools routinely consider whether a pupil has a disability as opposed to additional support needs and how to meet those? Because there is a difference, as we know. So I'll go, could I go with Mike first, please, and then other members of the panel can come in on that, maybe Louise.
In short, yes, I think they do, because I think that there is, you know, very clear information in schools that goes to teachers. And we touched on the primary to secondary transition just there, and I think there is, you know, much improved these days information that goes between primary and secondary schools, and then goes, you know, within, particularly in a secondary school where maybe it can be more of a challenge because there are so many teachers for a pupil, but information that goes out to those teachers, you know, via the guidance pastoral team, etc., in terms of what that teacher should be aware of and strategies that they can use for a disabled pupil or indeed a pupil with any additional support need.
And Mike, it might be helpful to sort of like just tell us, because that is complex, it's multi-agency, and that requires time, and you know, you've got the teacher at the heart of that because they're seeing the pupil regularly, whether that be single subject or, you know, for the whole day. So how effective is it at the moment, and do you think that there is scope in the bill that would improve that process? And at that point, I think definitely other people will want to come in on that.
Well, you've touched on what is the major issue of time, but I think that applies much more to, you know, the guidance and pastoral teams and sometimes the link deputy heads who are trying to arrange things, or when you know, things change or develop in terms of maybe more support is needed for a particular pupil, in trying to make sure that the resource is available or that other teams are involved. I think that's where the biggest challenge lies, you know, particularly. For the most part, I think the classroom teachers probably do feel that they get clear information, you know, for the most part, to do their best for the disabled pupils in front of them, I think.
Okay, thank you, Mike. Louise?
I think in theory, the first question you asked around the difference between disability and additional support need, yes. I think in practice, I think that communication doesn't always streamline. I don't think always information comes through in the way that it should do. And I think with the best will in the world, information is shared, but it isn't then disseminated to those that need to know. And to give you an example of that, from a primary to a secondary transition, is a pupil who was a type 1 diabetic, who the coordinated agencies weren't in place, and she landed at high school and they weren't able to support her, and there was nobody there to monitor and manage and support her to access her learning. And that's just one example. But I do think that, and to echo Mike, I think that in pockets, teachers are made aware of what children need and that information is disseminated. But in terms of reasonable adjustments and what might be required, I don't think that that always filters through. And I think from a leadership and culture perspective, I think it's about how people understand it and the importance of it. And I think that's, again, with policymakers and how they expect schools to implement processes and how to do that. So I think we have very good people in schools that are doing their very best, but they need the support and the resources to be consistent with that, and I think that's a challenge.
Okay. That's a good example, actually, of the transition bit. Is there anyone else on the panel that wants to come in on that? I've just got... I'll move on. So does the panel agree that everyone who meets the Equality Act definition of a disability should automatically have a transition plan, or should there be an element of self-identification and an opt-out process? I think previously in some of the answers, you know, young people might not want to declare they're disabled for whatever reason. And whilst the equality guidance, it says that in most cases, in the vast majority of cases, it will be evident that there is a disability. However, not always. So there is a bit of wiggle room there, isn't there? So it'd be good to hear your opinions on that. Anne-Marie?
Yeah, I do agree that everybody who is covered within the Equality Act, but in terms of the young person getting the services, so Dr. Whelan mentioned that, you know, the DSA, but so mental health would come under the Equality Act. So if a young person was to say that they had anxiety, it would be covered, but would they get... So it would be managing the expectations from that. Just, am I making myself clear?
I think so.
Yeah. So for an example, if somebody has anxiety for over a period of 6 months, under the Equality Act, that could be termed as a long-term condition and as a disability. So then if the young person would be, let's say, going to university or college and needs the funding for the disability, they may not meet the criteria in that way, but they would still get the service from the college or university.
Okay.
So from a personal allowance point of view, perhaps not, but from a service point of view, absolutely.
Right, okay. So, and do you think that this bill then would sort of like make that a bit clearer, or it wouldn't actually alter that process at all? Louise, maybe?
I think that for people who don't want to identify with having a disability, I'm not sure that they would recognise that this would bring them value, because it's about the work that we do with people to help them to understand. So to give you an example of someone that I have supported through a process to attend university, he does not want to identify as having a condition. His learning is online, and he receives benefits, he receives support, but he absolutely doesn't want university to know that he has a condition. He's academically capable. What he can't do is manage the workload, the time management, deal with the social aspect of it, and it's overwhelming for him. But he will not allow us to engage with the university support team to find alternative and reasonable adjustments to support him. So on the one hand, absolutely, in certain pockets for certain populations, yes, but when we're working with people who would identify of coming and requiring that support and they don't want it, is very difficult, because how do we support a university as well as support the person to do that? So he has withdrawn from his course because he can't accept his condition, and he can't accept the failure that he is viewed as his life, because he can't complete that part of his course. That's a very real example of what that looks like, and you work with people to try to help them to understand how this can benefit them, but they don't want to be identified under that category or that criteria. It's very, very,
I think,
difficult.
You've highlighted there how individual it is, and you know, every young person is individual in their own journey. Yeah. The reason why I'm asking about the scope and exploring that is because obviously the amount of young people that come under that, that's going to have a direct effect on resourcing and the financial sort of implications of that. So that's why. Thank you.
Mike Corbett wants to come in on response to that.
Yeah, it was just briefly that I do think that point is important about young people who are maybe reluctant to self-identify as having a disability. And that highlights the irony, perhaps, because why is that? I mean, we have teachers who are still fearful sometimes of declaring a disability because they feel it'll somehow count against them. And it's the same thing with some young people. How do you address that? Well, having a bill like this, you know, and this discussion helps that, and that's the irony, perhaps. So, but we do need, you know, again, at the top level, the very, you know, loud declaration that having a disability is nothing to be ashamed of. But that, I think, is still that challenge at the individual level with many young people and even adults, as I say.
Thank you. Was there anybody else that wanted to...
I was going to say that there's absolutely a role for maybe universities to disseminate information about, you know, what you were saying, kind of normalising declarations of disabilities. So most universities now are probably well over 20% of the student population declaring a disability. So we're talking one in five. It's not unusual. And often when I have conversations with students and I explain, you know, actually, here's the numbers of students who are like you, it tends to prompt that declaration then, because it is more normalised. But actually, sometimes the flip point from what you were saying is we are often seeing a lot more self-declarations of disability that might not meet the criteria of the Equality Act. So at my institution, for example, of the number of students that would declare a disability, only around 60% might have a formal support plan. So there's something about students wanting to tell us they might not need something. They might have had support in school, but they want to let us know just in case something's going to happen in the future. And I think that's been what's driving the increase in mental health declarations within the disability numbers.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, convener.
We'll go back a little bit in terms of our work, how we've been working through our questions today. Can I move to Ross Greer now, if that's okay? Thank you,
Thanks,
Ross.
Thanks, convener. Primarily for Mike, because you mentioned right at the start of the session around the Morgan review, there have been two revisions to the Additional Support for Learning strategy or Additional Support for Learning action plan since then, and there's at least half a dozen different references to transition in there and improving transitions. I'm interested if that has filtered through at all, those repeated updates to that national strategy. Have they actually filtered through to schools, or even from your work, are you aware of them filtering through at local authority level?
I think that's one of the key issues, is that I think if you asked any classroom teacher about that, very few of them would have that awareness on the ground, and I think that is a real challenge.
And on the point that's been raised a couple of times around the variation between both children and adult services within a local authority and the variation between different local authorities, there's two schools of thought about what this bill could achieve. One is that it would force a level of consistency, but the alternative point of view is that this potentially results in more tension, because it's not about creating a consistent approach across between children's services in general, across every local authority, or between adult social care services. That's a different debate we're having in relation to the National Care Service. There's a danger here, potentially, that this adds more tension, because you will still have a different approach between a local authority's children's services and their adult social care, but you will then have a third element now, which is what this bill expects nationally. Do you have any concern that rather than create more consistency, this just adds a third different approach that the other two will have to wrestle with, the local authorities' pre-existing practice?
Potentially, but I think the key is that the authority is able to work that out between their interdepartment working, partnership working, because the key is that the consistency remains for the person that's in the transition. So how a local authority and how a department works together to make sure that their practices internally work with between departments is important, but actually the key is that the consistency doesn't change for the person that's having the experience. So how do they do that? And I think that's the important bit, because I think it's about interpretation of it, and I think it's about implementation and prioritising, and I think it's about workload, and it's about recognising where it sits. And I think, to go back to Mike's point earlier about all the other different elements of guidance and frameworks and GIRFEC, it's if this straddles adult and children's services, adult services might look at it quite differently than they would from GIRFEC, because they would potentially see a GIRFEC not applying hugely in their setting, although it does under the legislation in terms of how you define a child and when they transition. However, it maybe brings more consistency to that. So that would be my view.
No, that was useful. Thanks.
Anyone else want to comment on those? Nope. Okay. We'll move to questions now from Bob Doris, please.
Thanks, convener. It was an interesting exchange near the start of the meeting where I was asking Anne-Marie Sturrock about whether the bill was required. And I think Anne-Marie and Dr. Whelan had mentioned about it bringing clarity and a more consistent way of identifying young people with disabilities or additional support needs, irrespective of what the current position is with local authorities. So I'm just wondering what the resource impact may be on colleges and universities. If the expectation is more young people were identified more regularly, more consistently, would colleges and universities be able to support the planning process by taking part in meetings, ensuring the agreed support is in place, and so on, for students from multiple local authorities? And I know further education has got more of a footprint in schools than perhaps higher education does, but are we anticipating additional workload? Has that been quantified? And is further higher education in a position where they can deliver? There's significant expectations within this legislation, so can we deliver on that? Maybe Anne-Marie Stark, have you given any thought to that?
Yeah, I've given a lot of thought to that, because the colleges, our guidance team, our structures in place just now are resourced and bursting, because 29% of people in Scotland's colleges just now have a declared disability. If there was an increase in that, I think colleges across Scotland would be concerned about the resource requirement, because what we're all about is getting it right for every student and every student with a disability here. So if there was a perceived increase, I would be concerned about what additional resource we would need to put in. I think the resource that we have put in, have in place just now, is very good for people with learning disabilities. It's excellent for people who have come through a schools-college partnership. But what resource would be required for people who, you know, come through that may have not just declared something 2 weeks before they start college? You're running to make it right for the person to start on usually the 19th of August. So I would be slightly concerned about what additional resource would be required.
Before I bring Dr. Wheeler in, can I just nudge you maybe a little bit more on that? Because if the bill is required, then surely many more young people will be captured. Yeah. About the need for transitions that are just off the radar just now, or don't have the plans that are required. So would you agree that 29%, if this bill works, will go up quite substantially? So therefore, there must be quite significant resource issues. Would you agree with that?
Yes.
Yeah.
The bill mentions a plan. So if there's more people requiring a plan, it's the implementation of the young person's plan, disseminating the information to all the curriculum teams, making sure to support. The plan is one thing. Implementing the plan, reviewing it at regular stages is really, really important. Meeting the expectations of the plan. So whoever wrote the plan would have to be in part of the college process. You would write it in partnership with the transition teams.
Okay.
Does that make sense? Because if the plan just came to the college, there could be a risk of misinterpreting for the young person.
It's incredibly helpful. I just want to make sure that Colleges Scotland and Further Education have thought about quantifying what additional resource might be required from their end. Has consideration been given to quantifying that additional resource that would be required?
I wouldn't say across Scotland that's been considered just now. I'm speaking on behalf of Colleges Scotland today. If the plan, you know, we would have to go back, look at the devil in the detail because of this 29% from a kind of I work in a college, I would know I'd have to resource our guidance team with an additional individual who's trained on transition. There's a training need here as well.
I'm not remotely trying to walk her, just because additional resource may be required doesn't mean it's not the right thing to do. I'm just trying to tease out the realities of the legislation. Dr. Wheeling, from a university perspective.
I mean, I suspect the impact on resourcing within universities would be less than it would be in the college sector, just because the Scottish students are a subset of our overall student population for most of the institutions. And, you know, year on year, we have been coping with an increased number of declarations. And, you know, that does put strain on the service, but we can manage and we can adapt, and we're to some degree used to that. I think it comes down to the detail as to what does a transition plan look like, what does it contain, and is it mindful of the context, whether that's college or the context of a university, and how that might be different. And so can a transition plan help with that transition to a different environment, a different sense of independent living, a different learning environment as well? And I think the other challenge. I mean, in the written submission, we talk about time and resourcing at that critical point in the summer, just before universities start in September. And as I said earlier, we work with the student, and at the moment, we don't have very much involvement with the local authorities. So again, because we're tending to work with 18-year-olds, we consider them adults, so it's hard to predict how much liaison we would need with this plan with local authorities and kind of a coordinated approach per individual student. So I think it's not clear at the moment for us to be able to say definitively.
Okay. I think that's reasonable. Louise Story, I don't know if I'm misquoting you. I apologise if I am. I've got mixed up with my scribbles in front of me here. I think you mentioned that there will be different priorities within schools in relation to transitions, young people with more complex needs, and the resource implications and resource pressures. So I think you're generally supportive of this legislation, yes, if I've got that right. But if resources are finite, might that prioritisation mean that some young people have plans on paper without the resource to make it meaningful, and other young people with more complex needs get a more significant transition? Any concerns in relation to that?
Quite possibly. I think it's, again, that variable picture that you get, and I think resource allocation across different settings looks different depending on funding availability. I think there's also the ability, and I think what needs to be taken to account to that is the current challenge in recruitment across the sector just now, and how to retain. So getting the right people into positions that are able to support that. So I think, yes, I think probably depending on need, there's variances on whether, yes, what your plan on paper comes to life in a different way from someone else who might have more specific needs.
Okay, and Mike, before I bring you in, I have one final question to ask. Maybe ask that, I'll come to you first, Mike, and that'll give everyone the opportunity to respond if they wish. So we know that most young people will come through a local authority route, through an education route, but not necessarily everyone. We know with universities, those young people may have effectively left school, and there's that flux during the summer, so local authorities might not always be the best place to take the lead. But there's an expectation local authorities would take the lead in transition cases. Should that always be the case, or is more flexibility required, do you think, Mike Corbett?
I think from a school perspective, you know, we would hope and expect that local authorities would be taking the lead, and that would be useful. If I could just, you know, rewind slightly,
yeah,
to
please,
your resource,
yes,
point. I mean, that's obviously crucial, and in the current circumstances where we've got that commitment to teacher numbers, which obviously we support because you need those teachers there to offer this service as well as many others, we have found traditionally that additional support needs and similar areas often seem the quite softer areas to maybe make some cutbacks in. So there would be a worry in the immediate future about that in terms of resources from our point of view, I think.
Okay, no, thank you for adding that. Any other comments on who should take the lead? We take Louise first and then Anne-Marie, if that's okay.
Okay to make a comment on the resources?
Yeah, sure.
I think relating to resources as well, there's the resource need around direct support, but there's also the resource need around dealing with families and the level of time that's required to engage with families when they require clarity, when they look for information. So whilst on the ground in a school, you're dealing with allocating the resource to the child, you're also allocating the time of another teacher or a pastor or a guidance teacher to dealing with the families, fielding the calls, following up what's required. And I think that's quite challenging as well. To go to your question around leading on transition, I think in some cases that health probably need to be considered in terms of what are the needs of the person at that time, and does health need to be involved in leading that transition? And I think that goes back to those variances around somebody's mental health. I think it also goes back to the variances of people's mental health around understanding somebody's condition and whether the resources are meeting the needs of somebody's condition, and if they're not, then does that impact on someone's mental health?
Okay, thank you. That's very helpful, very reasonable points. Anne-Marie Stark, did you want to come?
Louise took the words right out of my mouth. I think health would play a part, because if we were to say it was just purely local authorities, there could be a gap. We have a significant number of children in schools with health conditions, so they may not have a social worker. they would need, that the health would play a key role in the transition arrangements. So I agree with Louise.
And Dr. Whelan, just before you come in, I won't come back in for a follow-up question, convener, but you've said quite a lot, Dr. Whelan, about the real challenges for universities, about the lateness of identifying which young person's going to which institution. So that kind of, if you like, deep building relationships, early transitional relations, transitional plans are more difficult with higher education. So who should take the lead? And this might be your opportunity to say, is there something we could change, irrespective of this bill, to give universities more of a chance to build deeper, stronger, quicker, more meaningful relationships with young people before they go to university?
I mean, on the question as to who should take the lead, I think it very much depends on the individual student need, and not in relation to disabled students, but I've certainly supported students who are care experienced who actually had, you know, their social worker come and help with that initial transition and move to university and the value of that, but that's very resource intensive. But I just want to echo what's been said about health and particularly around mental health and the resourcing on the universities to some degree plug some of the gaps, and particularly around mental health support, around counselling support. And that is a big resource challenge for us, where that coordinated transition support and that the health element is sometimes missing. What more universities can do to kind of be more proactive? I'm really hoping that the pilot project University of Scotland has done around admissions and supporting disabled students throughout the admissions process is going to be quite critical to this. So I think once that gets published and that can be shared, and I think those pilot principles then can be disseminated across the sector as well. Yes.
Thank you very much. We've heard a lot today about transitions from people into the education system, colleges and universities. But how does the education system, the schools, ensure that there is a suite of opportunities for disabled young people after they leave school that might not necessarily be around the college or the university sector? Work, apprenticeships, schemes through charities like Enable. Can I perhaps go to Louise first, if that's possible? Yeah.
I think through person-centred planning processes, it's helpful to identify what avenue somebody would want to pursue. And I think it's when the value in people recognising that there's other avenues to success and opening that up to informed choice around, you know, Skills Development Scotland and apprenticeships and helping people to have those experiences, those link-ups with the local community. So, for example, things like through men's sheds and things that are very practical-based experiences and engaging in the community and community participation. I think for people that don't want to go on to further education, I think it's the who does that, who leads on that, because the support is about you filling in your application to university, you moving on, so who helps to support that, who helps to identify what might be right, and is it that cliff edge that stops of you're not pursuing college, you're not pursuing university, so what are you doing? So I think there's probably a gap in how we support that and how we access opportunities for people.
And Mike, can you respond to that as well?
Yeah, just following on precisely from what Louise said there, I think that is the concern of a lot of teachers would be, particularly if, you know, they are doing all they can to perhaps, you know, help a young disabled person into employment or, say, an apprenticeship. But they help them perhaps through the application process and let's say they're successful. And then really that is the end of the school's involvement. And as Louise says, who then picks up with that, you know, that young person when they've moved into, say, the apprenticeship? So I think there is potentially a gap there that needs to be addressed.
Yes, come in. Yeah.
Could I just make a point in relation to disabled pupils and students who are in mainstream schools and who are achieving and following their national fives or the national fours, and the reasonable adjustments that are in place from an assessment criteria point of view that might be limiting in terms of those people accessing normal opportunities as per their peers, because the assessment criteria to pursue that particular qualification doesn't fit the criteria of assessment for the governing body. So that can be limiting. So we're potentially
examples of specific
yes,
examples.
Yes, uh-huh. So a pupil who is pursuing NAT5PE, mm-hmm. who has a disability, who has been pursuing it, has got the support of the school to do that. However, the SQA assessment criteria is not enabling a reasonable adjustment for her to be assessed in the way that would be suited to her needs, and is pursuing and suggesting that she takes up a disabled sport that is one that she doesn't identify with, and two, isn't something that she's interested with. So she's at a crossroads in terms of what does she do and what does her family do to support that. And that's an example of sometimes our systems and processes may limit the opportunities.
That's made the hairs on the back. That's quite concerning to hear that, Louise. And that shows the power of examples, I think.
And certainly if anyone wanted other examples or further information on that particular situation,
that would be very useful.
I can do that for you.
Thank you. Dr. Whelan, please.
Just for transparency, I should also say that I'm a trustee of the Scottish Commission for People with Learning Disabilities, so this is probably a bit more of a personal opinion, but I think there is absolute scope to talk about who goes to university and who doesn't go to university and who gets included in those conversations. And you mentioned Enable Scotland, and there's been initiatives in partnership with the University of Strathclyde, for example, with Breaking Barriers, where it's providing opportunities for students for whom higher education would not be a traditional route for them, but to give them that opportunity linked to employment. And I think there's real scope and opportunity to look to other best practice in this area. So, for example, Trinity College Dublin has the Centre for People with Intellectual Disabilities. So marrying up kind of an academic qualification, whether that's at kind of certificate or diploma level, with work opportunities, internships, that often is leading to paid employment. And the benefits for the students, for the institutions, is, and actually for the employers as well, is vast. And I think this is just an opportunity to talk about who do we consider as, you know, the higher education is a route to. And I think we need to actually open up that conversation and look to whether there's opportunities to fund initiatives like that, because there is best practice elsewhere. And we can open the scope of who gets to have that experience.
I would agree. I think sometimes we have situations where we don't recognise what somebody would want, and maybe look at the condition and look at the limits in our own understanding of the condition, and narrow that to the limits of what they're able to achieve, and maybe people slip through the net because people assume that someone can't pursue a career or an avenue that they would want to.
Thank you for that those responses. Can I move to a final question from Graham Day, please?
Thank you, Convener. I think we're all deeply grateful for your evidence this morning. It's been very thought-provoking. But if you could just indulge me, I want to take this off on a slight tangent. Today, understand the way we've been talking about the bill and what it sets out to do. But let's imagine we'd invited you in not to talk about a bill. Let's imagine it didn't exist. And we were simply asking you, what one, two, three things could we do to change existing practice and approach that would make substantial difference to the experiences of these young people in the context of what you do or a wider context? What could we do if we were looking at a bill that could fundamentally change and improve a situation that quite clearly needs to be improved? Mike, we'll start with you.
Repeating points that have been made throughout, better coordination of the various, you know, pieces of legislation and guidance that are there already, an absolute commitment to resource things properly, and I think a stringent evaluation framework so that we don't just aim to do something that at some specified point we take a step back and judge, well, has this worked or not, and if it's not, let's try something else.
Anne-Marie?
So it's a very interesting question, and I'm going to kind of answer it from my experience of working with people with learning disabilities. And the biggest challenge was the changing in staff throughout their journey in their life. You know, that it's shift changes. We've got recruitment issues in social services just now. You know, we've got people who go off sick. We have teachers who leave. And then the whole thing, we talk about a transition process and a plan, and that's great if everybody knows what's on the plan. So if I leave work tomorrow and Mike is the person, who's going to pick it up from there? Who's going to make this journey really, really simplistic and smooth? Because you're absolutely right. Not every student with a disability wants to come to college. We would love them to, but they don't want to. And sometimes it's very difficult sitting in a meeting with a parent in the school, and the young person's voice is probably the quieter voice. So we don't lose sight of who we're trying to support here. But to me, it's consistency for the family, consistency for the young person, not have to say the same thing over and over again because of shift change or a staff, or you've moved to America or something like that. It just needs to be consistent for the family. The young person needs a point of contact, somebody they can trust, somebody who will listen and understand them, and their needs are at the forefront.
I suppose to support that would require perhaps one piece of documentation. Mm-hmm. That explains all their needs, yeah. What they require, and it's just picked up and run with.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. And Dr. Whelan.
I would say consistency would be the number one thing. And as you talk about, something that is consistent throughout that transition in terms of that documentation, because at the moment we don't align it. So what they have in school is not sufficient for what's required at universities or the disabled students allowance. So actually changing that approach, and maybe it's something radical about giving the universities the autonomy to decide where the DSA funding is going, rather than requiring that kind of diagnosis, which is putting, you know, burdens on the student, burdens on the NHS to provide documentation. So I think that's one really critical change that would make a huge difference for students. And the other is just greater opportunity of choice. So providing more choice maybe within universities, within colleges, within other avenues, so that students are getting the choice that they want and the pathways that are meaningful to them, rather than just something that, you know, is decided for them as something that would be useful for them to do. It's their decision as to the path that they want to pursue.
Okay, thank you. Louise Story.
Acceptance of difference. You know, I think we need to accept that everybody's different, and I think that is a cultural approach around values and understanding fundamentally why we're saying what we're saying about what people need, and I think that's about acceptance of difference and inclusion.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much for your time today. We found it a very informative session, as ever. The public part of today's meeting is now at an end, and we will consider our final agenda items in private. So thank you and good morning.